viruses, they cause diseases in human beings. Rhinoviruses, they represent one such group of viruses which causes one of the most infectious disease, that is common cold. Now, they infect the nose and the respiratory passage, but not the lungs. The common cold is characterized by nasal congestion, and discharge, sore throat, hoarseness, cough, headache, tiredness, etc., which usually lasts for 3 to 7 days. Droplets resulting from cough or sneeze of an infected person, they are inhaled directly or transmitted through contaminated objects such as pens, books, cups, doorknobs, computer keyboards or mouse, etc., which can cause infection in the healthy person. Now, some of the human diseases, they are caused by protozoans also. Now, we have heard about malaria a number of times. It's a disease which a man has been fighting since many years. Now, Plasmodium, it's a tiny protozoan, is responsible for this disease. Now, Plasmodium, different species of Plasmodium like Plasmodium vivax, Plasmodium malaria and Plasmodium falciparum, they are responsible for different types of malaria. Now, of these, the malignant malaria, that is caused by Plasmodium falciparum, which is the most serious one, and it can be fatal also. Now, let us study the life cycle of Plasmodium. Plasmodium enters the human body as sporozoites. It enters the human body as sporozoites, infectious forms through the bite of the infected female Anopheles mosquito. And the parasite multiplies within the liver cells. It multiplies within the liver cells and then attack the red blood cells, that is RBCs, resulting in their rupture. You can see in the diagram here, this is the life cycle of Plasmodium. Now, the rupture of the RBCs is associated with the release of a toxic substance that is called as hemozoin. Now, it is responsible for the chill and high fever that is recurring every 3 to 4 hours. And when a female Anopheles mosquito bites an infected person, these parasites enter the mosquito's body and undergo further development. The parasites, they multiply within them to form sporozoites, which are stored in their salivary glands. And when these mosquitoes bite a human, these sporozoites are introduced into his or her body and then initiates the events all these events which we have seen here. Now, a malarial parasite requires two hosts. One is human and another is mosquito to complete its life cycle. And the female Anopheles mosquito is actually the vector or the transmitting agent. So this is how Plasmodium completes its life cycle in the human beings. Now, this mature infective agents or sporozoites, they escape from the intestine and migrate to the mosquito's salivary glands. Here we can see it migrates and lives in the salivary gland when it bites the humans. And this is the sexual stage or the gametocytes, which develops inside the red blood cells, and the red blood cells, they ruptures when they multiply there. And hemozoin is another important chemical that is released when they multiply inside the RBCs, which causes all the symptoms of malaria. Entamoeba histolytica, that is again a protozoan parasite, it's a protozoa, and it is in the large intestine of humans, which causes amebiasis or amoebic dysentery. Symptoms of this disease include constipation, abdominal pain, cramps, stools with excessive mucus and blood clots. Now, house flies, they are the mechanical barriers which serve to transmit the parasite from the human feces to infected person, to food and the food products, and then contaminating them. Drinking water and food contaminated by fecal matter, they are the main cause of infection. So again, hygienic conditions need to be maintained. So this is the structure of Entamoeba histolytica, which enters the humans through the contaminated food or water. Ascaris, it's a common roundworm. And these are the helminths. They belong to the category of helminth worms, which are known to be pathogenic to man. And Ascaris is an intestinal parasite, and it causes ascariasis, a disease called ascariasis. And symptoms of this disease are internal bleeding, muscular pain, fever, anemia, blockage of the intestinal passage, and the eggs of this parasite, they are excreted through the feces of the infected person, which contaminated soil, water, plants, etc. And a healthy person acquires this infection through contaminated water, vegetables, fruits, etc. Wuchereria, Bancrofti, and Wuchereria malai. So these are the filarial worms. These are called as filarial worms, and they cause a slowly developing chronic infection or chronic inflammation of the organs in which they live for many years. Usually the lymphatic vessels of the lower limbs, they affect, and the disease is called as elephantiasis or filariasis. Now this is this worm, filarial worm, you can see here in the picture, and the kind of the symptoms that appear in the individuals with elephantiasis or filariasis. Now the genital organs are also often affected, resulting in gross deformities. And the pathogens, they are transmitted to a healthy person through the bite of a female Anopheles mosquito. So this is how this elephantiasis occurs in human beings. Many fungi, they belong to the genera Microsporum, Trichophyton, or Epidermophyton. They are responsible for ringworms. Now it is one of the most common diseases in human beings. You can see here such kind of patches, they do appear in the skin, a person affected by ringworms. Now appearance of dry scaly lesions on various parts of the body such as skin, nails, scalp, they do appear. They are the main symptoms of the disease, and these lesions, they are accompanied by intense itching. And heat and moisture help these fungus to grow, and it makes them multiply in the skin folds, such as those in the groin or in between the toes. Ringworms, they are acquired from the soil or by using towels, clothes, or even the comb of the infected individuals. So maintenance of personal and public hygiene is very important for prevention and control of many of these infectious diseases. And measures for personal hygiene, they include keeping the body clean, consumption of clean drinking water, food, vegetables, fruits, etc., public hygiene, proper disposal of waste, excreta, etc. So these are some of the preventive measures. So here you can have a look at the Trichophyton, Epidermophyton, and Microsporum, these three types of fungus which are responsible for these ringworms. So in prevention of control, prevention as well as control of these diseases, we already know hygiene is very important. Consumption of clean drinking water, food and vegetables, proper disposal of waste, periodic cleaning and disinfection of water, reservoirs, pools, cesspools or tanks, standard practices of hygiene in public catering. Then infected person should be avoided, and it also to control or eliminate the vectors and their breeding places. There are various practices that can be followed. Then avoiding stagnation. You can see here on TV and in various newspapers, they keep telling you during such periods where the mosquitoes, their breeding period is generally very high in those particular times. Avoiding stagnation of water in and around residential areas, cleaning of household coolers, use of mosquito nets, introduction of fishes like Gambusia in the ponds that feed on mosquito larvae, spraying of insecticides in ditches, drains, etc. of the areas where the swamps are there. In addition, doors or windows, they should be provided with wire mesh to prevent the entry of mosquitoes. So these we have seen that the advancements in the medical sciences, they have armed us to effectively deal with most of these diseases. So we know that prevention is always better than control, better than cure, and use of vaccines and immunization programs have enabled us to completely eradicate some of the deadly diseases like smallpox, a large number of other infectious diseases like polio, diphtheria, pneumonia, tetanus. They have been controlled to a very large extent. So biotechnology is on the verge of making available newer and safer vaccines. So discovery of antibiotics and various other drugs, they have also enabled us to effectively treat these infectious diseases. So we know that prevention is always better than cure. You should always keep in mind, and you should prevent the diseases then instead of contracting the diseases and searching for the cure. Thank you for today.